knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we introduced homogeneous catalysis, a process in which both catalyst and reactants are in the same phase, usually the liquid phase. The reaction media typically consist of reactants, catalyst, and solvent. Application of homogeneous catalysis is mainly in the area of complex molecules, such as pharmaceuticals or fine chemicals, where high selectivity and mild conditions are imperative. In the chemical industry, much simpler products are typically prepared, and these can accept much more robust conditions. The type of catalysis usually exploited in the chemical industry is called heterogeneous catalysis, because the catalyst is in a different phase from the reactants. Usually, the catalyst is part of a solid phase, and the reactants are in solution or in the gas phase. The main advantage of this type of catalysis is the stability of the catalysts, which can usually be recycled, given that they do not have to be recovered from solution. However, the mechanism of this type of catalysis is more complex and less straightforward to depict than for the catalytic cycles we just saw. Catalytic cycles in this context also include several steps. Of course, the molecules first have to diffuse towards the catalytic surface. In most cases, they will then become adsorbed on the surface. Remember, adsorption is different from absorption, in that absorption involves the transfer of particles into another material, like water into a sponge, while adsorption involves the adhesion of particles onto the surface of another material. Adsorption consists of a variety of attractive forces, ranging from very weak van der Waals forces to very strong forces, in some cases actual covalent attachment of the adsorbed molecule with cleavage of a former bond, as is the case with hydrogen gas during hydrogenation. In many cases, one reactant can be more strongly adsorbed than the other, and in rare cases, adsorption activates only one of the two reactants, and this is sufficient for catalysis. The key step in the cycle is the reaction of the species involved, which must be adsorbed at vicinal sites, which is made possible given their capacity for surface migration, or the ability to move along the catalytic surface once adsorbed. The details of this type of reaction are challenging to pinpoint. After the reaction, the product must quickly desorb and re-enter the bulk phase. Clearly, the secret to effective catalysis is a strong adsorption process, but this interaction cannot be too strong, otherwise the reactants will be too stable to react. In addition, the product should not be too strongly adsorbed to the catalyst, otherwise product molecules will coat the surface and block reactant molecules from adsorbing. Balancing these tendencies is usually done by trial and error. An important goal of heterogeneous catalysis is to maximize the contact area between the catalytic metal and the reactants, because only the external layer of bulk metal participates in catalysis. Therefore, active metals are often deposited on an inert surface in a layer as thin as possible, so as to maximize the utilization of the precious metal. Active surfaces and inert supports can be combined in a large number of ways to produce a huge variety of potential catalysts, which are often tested empirically for a reaction of interest. One important difference between homogeneous and heterogeneous catalysis is the fact that in the former, all catalyst molecules, disregarding decomposition, are identical and all behave the same way, which makes reactions easier to characterize and reproduce. Surfaces, however, are not easy to construct reproducibly. Defects are common, and they actually make a very important contribution to catalysis. The formation of defects leads to variability in the reactivity of each single catalyst molecule or atom. A solid defect is defined as the distortion of the crystal structure versus the ideal lattice structure. Defect structures always form in solids and can be subdivided into a variety of types. The analysis of lattice defects in catalysis is actually a fertile research area in itself. Here we can see a few of the typical defects found in catalytic surfaces: point defects, line defects, and bulk defects, which describe different ways that the crystal structure can be altered. These and other types of defects result in variability for the catalytic performance of solid catalysts. Modern nanofabrication techniques are resulting in the formation of much improved surfaces with more precise control at the single atom level. Single-atom catalysis is touted as a brand new exciting field, which in the near future may provide us with much improved heterogeneous catalysts. Whereas solid catalysts are in general much more stable than homogeneous catalysts, they also have a finite life expectancy, which of course depends on the chemistry they are performing. Fouling is caused by the deposition of decomposed reactant materials on the surface of the catalyst, and coating the surface reduces catalytic performance. The surface can modify itself on heating, since active particles can be displaced by particles of solid support rising to the surface, a process called solid phase transition. In addition, metal particles can be lost from the surface into the bulk phase. This is called leaching, and sometimes the leached particles have activity of their own. Redeposition never occurs at the exact site where the particle was leached, and this results in a surface displaying variable reactivity. If the leached particles are lost permanently, the result is an erosion of catalytic performance. Given the importance of heterogeneous catalysis, the construction of improved catalytic surfaces is a very important area of research. A popular area of heterogeneous catalysis is a hybrid with homogeneous catalysis. We have seen that ligands can tune the reactivity of transition metals, leading to highly selective processes under mild conditions, and sometimes even highly enantioselective processes if the ligands are chiral. A way to combine the two areas is to covalently link these ligands to a solid support, so that the catalyst can easily be recycled at the end. This area is currently enjoying a lot of popularity. However, the fragility of many metal-ligand combinations we see in homogeneous catalysts extends to the immobilized versions, and often the overall turnover number is not improved by attaching the ligands to the solid supports. The fact that catalysts are in a different phase with respect to the reactants leads to the frequent application of heterogeneous catalysis in flow instead of batch. Homogeneous catalysis is usually carried out in batch, meaning that all reactants and the catalyst are added to the reactor, the conditions are adjusted, and at the end the product is isolated in the workup, whereas the catalyst is lost. In flow chemistry, the reactants are allowed to flow, either by the action of a gas or a solvent, through a fixed bed hosting the catalyst, and this is done at such a rate that molecules exiting the bed are fully reacted. This permits a continuous production of material and is advantageous in terms of speed and cost. To conclude, whereas homogeneous catalysis is much more powerful in terms of the variety of operations it can perform under mild conditions, up to 90% of the products of the chemical industry involve heterogeneous catalysis. So we can safely say that homogeneous catalysis has a much broader scope, whereas heterogeneous catalysis accounts for much larger product volumes. We will see examples of the most important industrial reactions as we continue through the series.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.